NatureCast.
Hold music. You want to avoid it, and so do your customers. So say goodbye to hold music and hello to faster, smarter support with Salesforce. Make service more personal and agents more productive using built-in trusted AI. Then watch costs and wait times drop and satisfaction soar. Support customers in a whole new way with Service GPT. Learn how at salesforce.com/service GPT.
Welcome to NatureBacked podcast, where we are talking with entrepreneurs about the green economy. My name is Tarmo Virki, and today I'm speaking with John Feltz, co-founder and chief executive of Cruz Foam. Enjoy the show.
Hey there, I'm Merit. I'm the CEO and co-founder of Single Earth, and we are building a nature-backed currency to empower you to fight against climate change and biodiversity loss. Sign up at single.earth and be among the first to switch to a truly sustainable, nature-based economy. And don't forget to join the discussion around climate change and biodiversity loss on our Discord channel.
Hi, John. Welcome to the Nature Pact.
Awesome. Thanks for having me.
Tell us in a few words, what is Cruz Foam? I've heard quite a bit over the last few years, but what do you exactly do?
Cruz Foam is a circular materials company, and we create regenerative biomaterials to help really catalyze global supply chains away from single-use petroleum-based materials and plastics. Really our mission, I would say, is tied around, you know, the ocean. It's about how can we heal the ocean. So.
I'm living by the ocean or by the Baltic Sea, and every spring when I go to walk on the coast, I see the enormous amount of work in front of you, or in front of all of us.
It's interesting. We've really looked at this through the lens of the ocean in a lot of ways, because it's first where the inspiration came from for Cruz Foam. It's kind of where me and my co-founder were most, you know, tied to personally, spiritually. And I think through our schooling and our experience in the industry, we saw an opportunity behind this material we were working with to change kind of the trajectory we saw what was happening to, you know, the oceans and the planet. And like you said, there's certain areas you go and it's just, my goodness, how has it gotten to this state? And I think that's really where we're just like, someone's got to do this. You know, I guess it'll be us. So let's go for it. So it's kind of that simple to a degree, as we've made the decision.
What was the beginning point?
Man, the beginning point was born definitely out of surfing. And so this was in 2016. Me and Marco were down here at UC Santa Cruz, kind of looking at what this material could do. It's called chitin. Chitin is the second most abundant biopolymer on the planet after cellulose. And it has a lot of interesting properties. And I think what we kind of really, you know, tuned into was this simple idea of nature has the answer. And it's kind of simple to say, but it's very complex when you kind of break it down. And it's understanding that a lot of times these huge, you know, problems that maybe seem too unapproachable, if you just kind of step back and really break it down and understand where the problem is coming from, a lot of times you're going to find ways in which you can get solutions from nature itself. And I think being out in the ocean, seeing this enormous amount of plastic entering our ocean, this material, ironically, chitin, is almost most abundantly found in the ocean. And it was kind of just this epiphany moment where me and Marco thought, this is something that just makes sense. And we went into the lab and, you know, I spent about a year in this basement lab doing testing. And it's funny, I think about it, I look back at some of the pictures I've taken, you know, over the ages, and no joke, outside of my lab was the styrofoam collection point of the entire school. And so every day I would walk past these just giant Gaylord boxes, overflowing styrofoam, broken, splooned across the ground of just trash that's going to go into a landfill. And It was just great inspiration, but it kind of just reiterated the need for what we were trying to do. And I think that's kind of where it started. It just started saying, hey, let's work with nature to figure this out, because it has so much that we can learn from. And that's kind of where, boom.
The styrofoam and ocean and surfing. Yeah, have you actually kind of, do they use styrofoam to make those surfboards, or have you run into the styrofoam when surfing?
Both. It's funny, you know, I would say our drive to start this company came from surfboards. Like, let's go change how surfboards are made and the materials that are made in surfboards, because typically almost all surfboards, unless it's made of wood, is made with a foam core. And a foam core is historically has been polyurethane foam. More recently, not recently, probably in the last decade plus, but recently to a degree, there's been a transition going towards EPS, expanded polystyrene, or commonly kind of known as styrofoam. And I think everybody knows that never goes anywhere. And so we kind of had this, you know, a great representation through surfboards of how materials could be made better, especially when you look at it was the medium in which we connected with the thing that we love the most, the ocean. Yet it was kind of one of the things that you could argue is destroying the ocean. And so it was just like a great framework of a way to, you know, really tackle and use our technology in a novel way.
How far are you today from cleaning those oceans? I guess that over the last five or 10 years, the problem has got worse a little bit.
Yeah, it's hard to be optimistic sometimes, but I think when we look at this, the way we're trying to approach it is really holistically and understand it's going to take multiple solutions and avenues of attack. You know, one great, you know, technology, I would say it's kind of a technology. I mean, it's kind of just physical, but it's become extremely effective is Boyan Slot's, you know, ocean cleanup program, clean up the Great Garbage Patch. It started out, didn't work at all. You know, I've chatted with them personally. It's just like, you know, we put out our first deployment and we came back with like 10 kilograms. We ran it 5 days in a row and it was always 10 kilograms. They reiterated it and they got it out. We're now they're pulling enormous amounts out of the ocean. The issue is we're only accelerating what we're putting in. And it's nearly impossible to play catch up on a, you know, increasingly flowing faucet of trash. And I think we obviously need to try to get out what's already in there, but the greater avenues of change and impact is going to become addressing it on the front end, stopping it from even reaching the ocean or even being produced. And that's where, when we look at how we want to attack it, it's more about providing the technology to the greater supply chains and industries where polystyrene and polyurethane just aren't being made. They're able to substitute it with a similar performing biomaterial that has none of the end of life issues. And a lot of times removes a lot of the front end issues where we're sourcing these things from areas where probably could be done a lot better. And we're not trying to take virgin product out of the ground. We're not trying to, you know, just have impact on both the back and the front. There's ways in which if you solve either one of them together, it's a very symbiotic attack. And it's going to be tough. I think, you know, right now there's, I don't want to say so little we've done, but it's just such an enormous problem. And from my viewpoint, our goal would be, you know, to stop all EPS packaging from being made. When that's going to happen, hopefully it was yesterday, but we're going as quick as we can. So,
I think the problem is a little bit similar like we had in the previous episode where there was a European company doing tap water. Basically doing filters to clean the tap water with a mission to stop all the plastic bottles. Everybody knows that the plastic bottles are bad for your health. Everybody knows they cost so much more than you could actually get from the tap. But sales of it is actually growing globally. So it's the kind of we have a solution. We have kind of good things which can actually solve the problem. But at the same time, there is, you know, in some places there is old industries. Some places there's probably some kind of perceptions which just, you know, destroying the planet around us.
Yeah, I mean, you're spot on. And that's where, you know, you need some forcing functions. You need multiple kind of, you know, factors of to influence the change. And from ours, I think when you look at packaging, there's been a few things that have kind of pushed it forward over the last years. You know, you could say some of these regulations, you know, you could say some of the cost maybe is makes sense for certain things, but ultimately where we saw a lot of the breakdown of adoption and buy-in is scale and cost. And what goes hand in hand with that, though, is also once you have brands that align and understand the need, it's mapping the timeline to an adoption rate that map that works for them. Because sometimes these sustainability, you know, sustainable products just take too long to scale. And getting buy-in and development pathways with these large brands, it's just a really uphill battle. That's one way in which we've tackled this, is we want to be able to make products and biomaterials that can be manufactured in the same ways, distributed in the same ways, and, you know, disposed of much differently. But honestly, I think when we look at the precipice of change that's happened, I think it's happened in the last year, at least for a lot of packaging we deal with, and it's in the e-commerce space. And I think you have the things like ESG goals, you know, EPR, extended producer responsibility, but the brands we talk to, and I think the shift that it's gone from, it's always kind of been a must-have, like we need this. Now it's become like we desperately are going to take this from you, is I think consumers have reached a point where it's not that they're demanding the change anymore. It's that they're so connected to the change that they weren't before. And what I mean by that is like so many products that used to get shipped to box stores and unpacked, the packaging was never part of the experience the consumer had or had to deal with. That has completely been flipped on its head, where now you have not only do these consumers need to deal with just enormous amounts of packaging that they don't want to, and they don't have the infrastructure to deal with, because you can't, you get one furniture and all of a sudden your garbage can's filled with EPS. You can't put anything in there for the next week. It's like, okay, where do I put all my trash for the next week? And then on the flip side, a lot of it is, in the past, packaging has been secondary to the product. That is no longer the case. I see, and I get so much feedback, it's a holistic product pack people are buying now. You're buying the packaging with the product. And ironically, a lot of times the packaging lasts longer than the product, which is just backwards as hell.
Yeah.
But I think really what we're seeing is brands are realizing there's a huge opportunity, differentiation and capturing the consumer in a way with the products through packaging that wasn't been a, that wasn't really thought of before in a way that's really leverageable. That's where I think we're seeing, you know, real avenues of change happening quickly with aligned brands.
Probably for many consumers, this merger of the packaging and the product kind of experience has come with Apple, I would guess.
Yeah,
already.
Yep. Apple's 10, a great example. 10, their user experience is through the roof, and they were ahead of the e-commerce game, I think, from the beginning, because they approached it that inherently. It that's just how you got your product to, and like you're saying, it is part of the product. When you open your app, you're like, this packaging is amazing, and you want to interact with it. You want to, you know, engage with it, and that's where we're seeing the shift.
Exactly. The other interesting kind of packaging startup I came across recently is an Estonian company called Vula. They use lamb. What do you call the? What you get from the lamb? The wool,
like the wool, like
the wool leftovers, and turn them into the packaging of the material. Hmm. A bit similar as you know you guys do with our plastics.
It's really interesting the novel kind of technologies that are coming out. Actually, when we first started this company and I think I was trying to do customer discovery to understand what the company was even going to be. And we're kind of coming off the tailwinds of surfboards. We tried to do surfboards for about 9 months, and I won't go into all the details, but it wasn't going to be a venture-backed company, let's put it that way. But then we also kind of understood like the impact was clearly not from surfboards that we were trying to change. It was through single-use materials. And one of the programs we went through is called the National Science Foundation. They have a program called the iCore, and it's to basically help you do customer discovery to find your business model. And I actually flew to Australia to do and went to the Australian Institute of Packaging. They had a conference there, and that was in 2018, I believe. I was first exposed to wool packaging there, and I was like, oh my goodness, like, who thinks of this stuff? And it was just such a great like tie, like you're saying. I was like, well, there's people who are crazy as I am out here trying to do these things. And why not? Let's put it together. And I think those are just fantastic. And why it's great to see, because so many people look at biomaterials and, you know, one company like ours and like, well, you're going to fix everything. You know, you're going to make foam for everything. And it's like, I wish, but like, let's be honest here. You look at plastics, there are how many different types of plastics just in foam? Like 10. And even in those, there's like ranges of grades of those different that all do something differently. So it's like, we need wool, we need PHA, we need Cruz foam, we need cellulosic foam, we need all of this stuff, because I guarantee you, we're going to find the markets where we can each play and add value different from each other. There'll be some crossover, I'm sure, but like, it's a combined effort. Like this needs to happen together.
Exactly. You touched a little bit about your history, some big developments, but if you look back to where you are now or what has been over the years reached, what have been kind of the maybe the biggest milestones or what are you the most proud of so far on your road?
That's an interesting question. I think there's twofold. You know, from the technical side, I think there's two things I'm really proud of. Early days, you know, we worked in like a 180 square foot closet, like with KitchenAid mixers, like just figuring out whatever we could do. But we were always on a pathway of wanting to make sure we could scale these materials with existing industry. It's where we knew it had to happen to actually work. And so originally it was doing surfboards. We literally made our own steel surfboard molds that we welded together and tried to foam a blank. That went so horribly wrong, but I was super proud of it. And then on the flip side, one of the things that I always laugh about, I don't know if I'm proud about this, it's just kind of a fun story, but my co-founder, we're at this point, we're like, okay, this is tough. Like, we need to find a way in which we can understand the true foaming of this that might scale a little bit better. And one of the things that he did, I think, would eventually led towards extrusion kind of abstractly, but he took our material home and actually put it in a cupcake tin and foamed Cruz Foam cupcakes. And he took them back to us the next day. And he's like, we turned this into foam. And I was like, Marco, you're kind of crazy. But it was like that moment where you saw like, okay, we can build on this. We can turn this into a scalable process, knowing that it's able to be done. And then tying that into, I think the other thing that I personally, I'm proud of more just from the risk point of view and my team point of view, we raised $1 million as our first kind of real venture money. We also got our first NSF SBIR grant for $225K. So we're about 1.2. This was, I think, just at the end of 2019 or beginning of 2020, right before COVID hit. And I didn't know that was coming. But literally, I took a chance and I was like, well, if we're going to do this for real, we need to get an extruder in-house. If we're actually going to make this through extruder, we need to get an extruder. And that is not, that's not something you just go do. And we had my employee, you know, number three, basically, he flew to Thailand. Spent 3 weeks in Thailand working with this Thai company around extrusion. Never been there before. We had no idea what we're doing. And he brought back this extruder and it was like literally dropped on our doorstep like in April 2020. We couldn't do anything with it. But I look back at that time point and making that decision and taking that risk leapfrogged us in so many ways that had we delayed, especially with COVID, it would have probably set us back way. We probably wouldn't be where we are right now. And it was just one of those things. It's like a startup. You just have to kind of like take your best guess and could have gone horribly wrong. But Matt was a freaking warrior over there and brought back an awesome machine. So those are good times.
Absolutely. And the other side, looking forward now in the kind of spring of 23, you just came out with a big announcement. What was that all about?
Yeah, our first product. So our first product's in our first large partnership with Atlantic Packaging. And so we're super excited.
The first product is not bakery related, right?
No, it's not. No. Not that we haven't gotten some demand for that. It's more for dog food. But no, the first products we're looking at are e-commerce solutions, really looking at high demand, both in protection and insulation. And so there's a Cruz foam wrap. There's a Cruz pack, which is kind of a protective mailer. And then there's a Cruz cooler. And they're all positioned to be curbside recyclable. And it's really understanding this need when you look at replacing things like bubble wrap for e-commerce types of solutions, bubble mailers. You know, there's some decent, I would say, recyclable mailers out there, but I would argue they've had very minimal protection. We actually are shipping more sensitive objects. And then finally, the cooler, which I think is really exciting. There's a couple solutions out there, I would say, that, you know, service maybe the food where the you know, food produce space for cold chain and the biomaterials or sustainable packaging. But I think our solution is really unique, both in its design. It has a really kind of awesome interlocking design that can be modularized, but also it's really added a higher level of integrity and durability to protection. So you think of things like medical, pharma, live seafood. Well, let's start shipping some lobster around. So it's kind of cool when you look at the response has been overwhelming. And I think doing it through someone like Atlantic Packaging is just the cherry on top. Their position, I would say, if not the top, one of the top, you know, sustainable packaging providers in North America, they are incredibly mission aligned with us. I would say like no one we've come across before. So we're super excited where this is going to take us this year. It's just beginning.
Oh, what about shipping bottles?
Haha, yes. It's like you already know. It's like you're part of the business. It's like you're part of the business, you know?
No, it's just my personal interest.
You're like, I need some good wine over here. It's interesting. You know, when we look at how we've designed our foam, we can produce it in a way that adds a level of protection we haven't seen with sustainable materials. And it's also the format in which we can make it. And that's really through large sheet extrusion. And where that is really kind of breakthrough is it allows us to produce and convert these sustainable materials that really hasn't been commonly done, I would say, in the past for biomaterials. There's always kind of a unique production method or a unique way of turning into a product. We can give this to, you know, people like AP or other ones in the same way they're getting their foam now. And so it really allows for this, you know, analogous and kind of lowering of, you know, frictionless transition, if you will, to adopting this and to productize it. And when you look at bottles, there's certain solutions out there, you know, shipping wine or shipping, you know, more just glass things in general. There's certain things where you put them in like a puffed up plastic bag, or maybe you have a styrofoam, you know, casing that goes around it. And that is definitely something we're trialing right now with a couple of interested customers around the cruise pack and how that can be adapted to different sizes. Because clearly the pack right now, we have a couple standardized sizes. If you start putting in larger and larger bottles, not that we can't service it, it might just be a slightly different design. But you're spot on. That's a huge market we see, especially here in California. I mean, there's an enormous amount of good wine here, you could say. So.
And online shipping in general of bottles. I've heard about Amazon tests of dropping the, I think it was one of the most wanted jobs at Amazon to be the testing of the packaging of spirits, that you have to drop them from, was it like meter or 1.5 meters on a concrete floor? And if it doesn't break, then that packaging is okay for Amazon. And of course, the testing person can keep the spirits.
I wouldn't mind that job. I think maybe that's where I'll go after Cruz Foam, is I'll go work at Amazon dropping spirits. That is awesome. No, we, you know, I won't go into details, but we've definitely spent some time, you know, looking at different drop tests, especially Amazon's, going to a handful of different facilities. And that's the benchmark a lot of times. Mm-hmm. You know, we've tested everywhere from dropping a little lotion bottle or you know, an iPhone to a freaking 200-pound stove with Whirlpool. And, you know, different material demand, clearly. But I think when we look at, you know, the opportunity here, the e-commerce space is just exploding. And there's so much need, as we chatted at the beginning, for people to have packaging that resonates with the consumer that's getting it. Because like my wife and me, we order like way more than we should from Amazon. But the amount of still bubble mailers we get, sometimes I'll get a recyclable mailer that has the product wrapped in bubble wrap inside that mailer. And I'm like, well, good try. I guess you tried. Like, it's half there maybe. Yeah. But that's where it's just, there's still so much room for innovation in this space. And that's where I think these products we're announcing are just really exciting.
And looking forward into the 2023, I assume that's the kind of the big, I don't know, proof case or the thing you guys are working on to show off to the world.
Yeah, those are the big ones. You know, we always have a ton of stuff in the back end. There's always some interesting R&D that might pop up here and there. We're getting some pretty active engagement and interest in multiple joint venture opportunities everywhere from maybe a surfboard to literally other projects. You know, there's things where foam does really, I mean, foam's in everything. You wouldn't think it, but it is in literally everything. And one of the most interesting markets for me, and this is probably 2024, you know, is looking at things like construction. You know, there's so much opportunity where we can take this technology, but 2023, let's get rid of as much terrible plastic material in the e-commerce space as we possibly can. Cause it, like I said, it needs to happen now. And so I think that's going to be our focus. And the quicker we can deploy here in North America, I think that would be our goal in 2023, and then replicate that internationally. Cause I don't want to say like, I mean, I'll just say it, they're further ahead, both in sustainability and there's a ton of demand and sourcing, production. And it's how can we, not modulate, but replicate what we're doing here to drop in globally while still having regional sourcing of supply, regional manufacturing, and regional distribution. Because that's how packaging's done today. So that's what we want to copy. Mm.
Good stuff. That's a good point to wrap up also our discussion today. Thanks, John, for joining us.
No, I really appreciate it. Thanks for having me. It's fantastic.
Classic 100, your ultimate classic rock station.
Hi, this is Roger Glover of Deep Purple.
Hey gang, how you doing? It's Joe Walsh.
Classic 100 on Obelisk.com. Download the Obelisk app from the Apple or Google Play Store and listen to the ultimate in classic rock on Classic 100.
Get your praise on with Praise 95, your home for traditional gospel grace and today's hits. You can listen to us on the Obelisk app or online at audilous.com/praise95. Oh, and don't forget our sister stations, Worship 95 and Rhymes 95. We have something just for you. It's Praise 95, your number one station for inspiration.